Welcome back to Spiritual Formation and Discipleship. This is Lecture 8, and what I'm going to be talking about in this particular module is the need for community in our spiritual growth. And there are a couple of things that come into play with that that we need to take a look at. You know, it's really easy when we get focused on personal spiritual growth to get so focused, laser focused in on me, that I forget that there's something bigger out there, that I'm part of the body of Christ and there's things to learn from others. So it's easy to let this practice of disciplines remove us from other people. We almost become like the monks of old, where I'm so focused on my prayer time and I'm so focused on silence and solitude that I'm no good to the body because I've kind of just pushed myself out into my own little corner. We want to make sure that we don't allow that to happen. Now, there's a place for that. I think probably most people err in the other direction by not spending enough private time alone with God and don't spend enough time reflecting and searching their inner person to see what's going on and what the Holy Spirit is trying to tweak within them. But when we get into that, there is that possibility of getting too removed and maybe even viewing ourselves as more spiritual than others, so there's no reason to do that. And so it becomes too much internal, not enough external relationships, and we miss out on those pieces of growth that we get from other people. Now, this can lead to what I call the just me and Jesus situation, which is very unbiblical. This idea that all I need is Jesus. And you'll hear this from people all the time. They'll say, well, I don't need to go to church. I don't need to be in a small group. Don't need to be in a class, any of this type of thing, because me and Jesus, we've got it all worked out and it's going to be just fine. That is an unbiblical statement, because we're told over and over again in Scripture about being in community, about being with others, how to treat others, how to love others, how to show love to others. And we have to have relationships for those things to actually happen. So we need to get back and rediscover the necessity of community for our personal spiritual growth, but also for the growth of the body of Christ as a whole. So a couple of foundational pieces to this. First off, God said it's not good for a man to be alone. He said that right off the bat at creation. And it wasn't just about marriage and romance. It was about relationships. Now, in that situation, God created woman to go with man, you know, so there would be that marriage and that type of relationship. But it is a larger statement, and it's very reflective of the Trinity. Because God himself is relational, and he seeks relationship. When the world was created, God is speaking, and he's talking to somebody. When he creates man, he says, let us create man in our own image. The Godhead is speaking. You know, our Trinitarian God, which is a theological concept that all of us struggle with, he's interacting. And he's seeking to create man so there would be further relationship and further opportunity for him to share the love that is him. And we, being created in his image, have this same natural desire for healthy spiritual relationships. We have a desire to both give and receive love. That's built into who we are. That is part of the Imago Dei, is to have that desire to love and to share and to commune. And we get lost in that sometimes because we like a lot of surface meaningful relationships where we just Facebook friends and all this type of stuff. Those are not real friendships. We're talking about needing real community, meaningful relationships that have an impact on our lives and where we can have an impact on the people that we're in relationship with. So here's why we need community, very specifically. I just kind of put it out there in a practical perspective. Community provides us with opportunities for friendship. And again, not Facebook friends, not social media friends. I've got people online that I barely even know who they are. I'm talking about people that we truly know them. We know their hearts. We know their motivations. We know their hurts, their pains, their needs, their strengths. And they know ours. People that we can depend on. The thing that Scripture talks about being the friend that sticks closer than a brother. We're talking about real friendships, which in our society here in America right now in 2016, 17, it's tough because we're go, 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 go. We're busy, busy, busy. And everything is about what can I get? What can I have? What makes me feel good? What makes me like my life or myself a little bit better? But we've got to learn to reach beyond that and develop friendships that will build us up and make us feel like more a part of something and not just this Lone Ranger mindset out there. So community provides us an opportunity for friendships. And within that context, we have an opportunity for encouragement and edification. Okay, that's the word scripture uses, basically the idea of Christians building up other Christians, encouraging each other, motivating each other in the spiritual life. You see, we have to have this because it's too hard in a lost world for us to get sidetracked. It's too hard for us to think that nobody else feels like we do. I think about the story of Elijah, another great prophet Elijah. And right after he wins this battle, this showdown between God and Baal on Mount Carmel, Elijah runs. He's done with the big event. He is spiritually taxed, he's exhausted. And he runs, and God takes care of him for a while. And he says to God, he says, "But I'm the only one." He gets into his whiny place. And we do it too, so I really can't throw rocks at him. But he gets whiny, and God listens to him and says, "What are you talking about? I've reserved all these other people who are over here that serve me and love me too, and we just need to get you to them." And we find that Elijah and the others actually spent time in groups of other people, other prophets and ministers and folks, encouraging each other, challenging each other, and building them up. So when life gets hard and we think it's just too tough, or nobody understands me, or nobody likes me, or I'm not accomplishing what I think I ought to accomplish, it's the community that we have, real community, not just membership in an organization, but people that we've chosen to have spiritual friendships with who can look at us and encourage us and speak the truth to us. Now, sometimes that truth is a little different, and that's what we call accountability. We need the opportunity to have people who care about us, who will hold us accountable for our actions and our attitudes. I need that. There are days that I have a bad attitude. There are days that I'm not doing what I'm supposed to be doing, maybe even weeks at a time, if I'm honest about it. And we need a group of folks, or a couple of close friendships at least, who know us well enough and care for us enough to speak into our lives and tell us when we're doing it wrong. You know, friends who will say, "You know what, Lee? That attitude is not going to get you anywhere." Or, "You know, I've noticed that you've been negative lately. You know, how's your prayer life?" Not accountability from this legalistic mindset. I've been through that one too, where we get into accountability groups and it's really just an opportunity for us to beat up on each other. That's not what we're talking about. Accountability is edifying. It is something that helps us to be better, helps us to recognize truth. And because often what we've done, it's not so much about bad behavior as much as it is believing a lie that the enemy puts before us, that something is better than God or that God is not enough. And accountability gives us an opportunity to pull each other back into correct alignment with the truth. Now, another thing it does, it gives us help and access to skills and gifts that we don't have. When I look at spiritual gifts, there are gifts I don't have. Okay, and some of you taking this class may say that mercy is one of the ones that I don't have after I've graded papers. And you may be right. But we all have things that we're weak in, and we have things that we're strong in. I think in the skill category especially, you know, I'm not a musician. As try as I might, 2 + 2 still equals 3 when it comes to music. I'm just not that good at it. But there's a place in my need, in my spiritual walk, that I need some musical worship. So I need people around me who can provide that opportunity. You know, there are things maybe in the function of my life. I'm not a financial guru. I can handle my budget. I've been through the courses. I can do those things. But when it comes to big questions about maybe money and investments and retirements and all this kind of stuff, I need a little help. Well, who do I need to go to? I need to go to a believer, a brother or sister out of my community who understands that better than me and can help me. The same is true with something as simple as a broken car. Those situations, I had an experience some years ago. Now, I'm pretty good with a car. My car broke down. I was out of town visiting a youth ministry organization I was working with, and I knew how to fix what was broken. But I had been in meetings all day, and I was dressed in a shirt and tie, this kind of situation, and I was just going to figure out how to get down to a T-shirt and get up under there and do it. One of the interns that I had guided and mentored over the years came out, and this guy was a better mechanic than I am. He looked at me, and he said, "There's no way I'm letting you get under that car. I'm going to fix your car for you." And this boy took time from his work and things that he was doing and fixed my car while I felt almost silly sitting there watching him. And he said, "This is what I do. and I have the access to go back in the house and clean up, and you wouldn't have had that. And he took care of me like that. We see that all the time. Opportunities to go out and rake the leaves for elderly couples that they can't do it themselves anymore. Community provides those opportunities to do that, to accept help and also give help by exercising our gifts and our abilities. And people come to me and they say, hey, I've got organizational questions. I need some leadership advice on something in my organization. That's an opportunity for me to sit down with them and say, okay, well, there's nothing for me to gain in that except to love on my friend. Or perhaps it's a teaching issue, or maybe it's some ideas bouncing back and forth with a staff member at the church. So those are opportunities for us to do that. And we are told that we're to grow in having a common mind and a common love among us. Scripture speaks of that, and finding that type of unity in spirit. Well, you can't have a unity and commonality if you're by yourself. Well, okay, maybe you can. There's nobody there to argue with you. Then again, maybe there is, depending on what kind of day you're having. But we have to be with others to work out our relational needs, to understand how to interact, to understand how to give and receive love and help. So community is so important to our growth in becoming like Jesus. He just didn't go sit on a mountain all day and stay there by himself. He had his private time. He had his time alone with the Father. But then he had his time alone with smaller pockets of disciples. And then he had the larger community that was a part of. And he interacted with them and was a part of the society that was around him. And he calls us to continue to do that as well. So I guess the big question then is, how do we find this community? Because let's face it, it can be tough. You know, sometimes we go to a church or Christian organization and we just assume that that will provide us with true Christian community. And unfortunately, more often than not, it doesn't. Most of my experience working in churches was those were not places of real community. There were pockets of real community within it. There were pockets of 4, 5, 6 believers that were together and they encouraged each other and provided that accountability and that edification and teaching and challenge that was necessary. But the church as a whole was just a large group of people. So you may find that to be the case. So the reality is, if you want to have real community, you're going to have to seek to develop relationships within that church or that organization. It's maybe easier if you're in a house church where there's smaller groups of people that meet together, but in a church with a couple hundred people, you've got to work to find those relationships. It has to be deeper. It has to be more connected than just sharing a pew together or going to the same class. You know, we were at one church where we were in the same class for a couple of years, and I knew the people's names, and they connected with us on Facebook, and we occasionally had a dinner. But I can't say that I really knew any of them deeply, and I can't say that they wanted me to know them deeply. I think they wanted to show up and just kind of move through their motions and go. But yet at the same time, there were other people, even from outside that class, who were coming in and sharing their lives and seeking to pursue a relationship and build a deep spiritual friendship. So you just have to put a little bit of work into this thing. But hear me clearly. We don't abandon church, okay? Just like we don't ever want to be alone in our faith, we're supposed to be connected with other believers, we don't abandon the body. We've been told not to abandon the body. Okay, I can say right now at this point in my life, the primary spiritual communities that my wife and I have are not from our church. We've changed churches within this past year, and we're still building those relationships. And our tight community groups are from just other Christians at large within the community that we know and we get together with and we have these type of relationships. Now, we still go to church. We go to church regularly. We participate. We're active. We're in things. I do some teaching there and the things that happen. But our deep-rooted communities are with people outside of that particular congregation. So often our strongest sense of community is going to be in a small group that we have chosen. I even have a small group of pastors that I know that they don't always get to find the community within the church they work at. And those are guys that kind of have an open door to come by and hang out with me. And we have those real relationships. So look for them. Find them. They are real and you can have them. But you have to be willing to be a part of it. You have to choose to be trustworthy. And you have to show that you're going to be a loving part of the group who really cares about the other people that are involved. All right, so let's talk about what it looks like. If you're looking to have discipleship within a community, There are a few things that you can do, all right? Now, I want to be careful here that we don't get so programmatic that we lose the spirit, okay? That happens too often. I think I've shared before that when I was growing up, discipleship was the class we had on Sunday night, and whatever was in the little magazine and curriculum, that was what we studied. That wasn't really spiritual growth and discipleship. It was more of a programmatic approach. But here are some things you can do within community to help build discipleship. First is to look at the idea of large group activities, things that have to have a lot of people, things like a big worship service, for lack of a better word, mission projects, big community events that you might put on, and outreach things, holiday events, those types of things. You have to have a large group for this to happen. For that matter, maybe if it's even, my brother was a part of a group that was a sports ministry when he was single, and they got together, they had Bible study, they had prayer, they built relationships, and they played sports. But it took enough people to actually fill out the teams to do that. Another idea here is small group activities. Now, these are some of the ones that I think have the greatest opportunity for growth within a congregation. These are groups of anywhere from 5 to 10, 15 people, probably not any more than that, who get together for Bible study groups. Okay, now notice I put a limit on the size for Bible study group. I know too many Sunday schools, or whatever we want to call them, that have 50, 60, 70 people in a class. That's a small church congregation. That's not a small group. The groups still need to be tight enough that we can interact with them and be intentional about growth and about sharing. So Bible study groups are a big part of this. Prayer groups, where people really get to know each other and actually are willing to pray for each other. And you know the difference as well as I do. You sit down with somebody to pray, you don't really know them, you're not bearing your heart most of the time. So I'm talking about groups that are small enough, intimate enough, that you're willing to share about the real needs in your life and ask people to pray for you, and you're willing to commit to regularly praying for them as well. Not just the whole, yeah, I'll pray for you in that, but really going to, and they know you're going to. And then there's support groups and accountability groups, and there's all flavors of those. Anything from related to addiction-related stuff, or parents with kids of the same age, you know, things you're interested in, whatever those might be, recovery-based kinds of stuff, marriage-based types of things, whatever it is, it's kind of an affinity group. And those work. And there can be places for spiritual growth and community within those if you choose to put it in there. Any group can turn into a spiritual group. Now, maybe the single most, for me as an individual, the most effective way to find community for my spiritual growth is to be in a one-on-one or a one-on-one-on-one or whatever that looks like type of group. This is a mentor and a mentee, a discipler and a disciple. And sometimes there's two or three in that group, but not usually any bigger than that, where it is direct. It is just right there, square, in your face, talking about your relationship with God and guiding you in something that you don't already know. And we've talked about this in other material we've covered in this course. These are important, but these are the things that get missed the most. I searched for that when I was young and had trouble finding worthy people who would spend time pouring into me that way. And I find now, even as I disciple others, I find that people within the church are often not looking to be discipled that way, not in a direct mentoring type of situation. But that is an opportunity to dig very, very deep with somebody and have some accountability and some guidance and somebody older, more mature spiritually than you to bounce these ideas off of, where Titus talks about, you know, the older men teaching the younger men, the older women teaching the younger women, the ideas. Somebody with a little experience in life to bounce some of these things off of that we come to. Because I'm sitting alone in the house reading and praying and thinking, I can come up with all kinds of stuff that may not have come from the Spirit. This is just giving a check for that, but also opportunities to be encouraged, challenged, new opportunities to do things as well and be guided by them. Opportunity to pray very deeply and very intimately with somebody. Scripture says, when two or three are gathered in my name, I'm there among them. This is that idea. Not 200 people in a room and we said a prayer and that was great, but actually a couple of people really getting down and seeking the face of God together and being very vulnerable with each other as they do that. And again, the accountability is stronger in these smaller groups. Now, be careful, though, with any of these, because there is a need to program it a little bit, especially in large group stuff. Otherwise, it can get completely out of control four or five different directions, no unified focus, no specific outcomes or goals that we're seeking. We're just kind of going through the motions. We want to make sure we program enough that we stay on track to accomplish something spiritually. But we also want to make sure that we don't over-program it to where we take away the spontaneity of the Spirit. We take away the opportunity for God to interject into our hearts to change and do something a little bit different within that. So these are some of the things that you can do. And you've got a project that's coming up in the class where you're going to be lining out some ideas for discipleship and spiritual growth. You can integrate any of the spiritual disciplines into these. I believe we've got some resources that we've listed in here where it even talks about how to do spiritual disciplines with your church, with your large group church congregation. And there are some things that simply go better with a large group. Evangelism, missions, service, those types of things, like I said, are easier to do with a group. But you need both. You can't be a good part of a spiritual community if you're not at a place that you're being good spiritually to yourself. You and the Father getting alone and doing your business, interacting with the Spirit, you know, communing, walking like Christ. We have to be seeking to do that individually as we come to the community, so that we help the community and the community helps us as well within that. So don't separate yourself. Don't pull apart from what's going on in the church, in the body of Christ around you.